Well, good morning. It's time for us to begin our Bible class. We are in Genesis chapter 6.
Oh, yeah. It's better start recording.
We're about ready to get into the flood. But before we get into the flood, let's go to God in prayer. Father in heaven, we thank you for the day that you have given us, and we thank you, Father, for now this opportunity that's before us to study a portion of your word. Father, help us to have a better understanding of the history of your people, that we can follow those things that are examples for us for the good, and Father, that we know that your word tells us that all things that were written for aforetime were written for our learning. And Father, we pray that we can take something away from our study of this crucial subject of the beginning of time and the beginning of mankind and the unfolding of the scheme of human redemption, Father. Father, we are indeed thankful for that plan, and we're indeed thankful for Jesus that was the center of that plan, Father. Help us to be more like him each and every day. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. In Hebrews chapter 11, I believe it's verse 8, the Bible tells us that by faith, Noah, being divinely warned of God, prepared an ark for the saving of his household, by which he became the heir of salvation according to faith, or the heir of righteousness according to faith. So his righteous act made him an heir. And we're told that as Christians today, as children of God, that we too are heirs, joint heirs with Christ. And so when we consider just how magnificent Christ is, and we think about what he has done for us, and you think about that plan, beginning in Genesis all the way through to the book of Revelation, and you consider that at the end of all of that, Jesus is no higher than you or me. We're joint heirs with Jesus Christ. He himself was made a little lower than the angels, just as we are. And when, of course, we've gone through this passage a number of times, but it's one that's comforting, and it's one that's just really unbelievable, to say the least. 1 Corinthians chapter 15, beginning in verse 24, on down to verse 28, it tells us that when he returns, he will deliver the kingdom back to the Father, and he will be subject to the Father. Now, we're going to be subject to the Father. He's going to be subject to the Father. That's something, that's a role that he gave up. Remember, he was equal with the Father, has always been equal with the Father. But the final portion of that role is that he's now going to subject himself. And it's present tense, which means keep on subjecting himself to the Father with us. So he left glory. He's done all of that for us to be on the same level with us for eternity. That is, any better description of love than that, I don't know what is. That's what he did for you and me. And so there's more to just Jesus dying on the cross for our sins. He left and gave up so much for you and for me. And so he too is an heir with us of the righteousness that has been provided for us, just as Noah was an heir of the righteousness based upon his righteousness. And so we're going to go look now at chapter 6, verse 13. And it says, "And God said to Noah, the end of all flesh has come before me, for the earth is filled with violence through them. And behold, I will destroy them with the earth. Make yourself an ark of gopher wood. Make rooms in the ark and cover it inside and outside with pitch. And this is how you shall make it. The length of the ark shall be 300 cubits, its width 50 cubits, its height 30 cubits. You shall make a window for the ark, and you shall finish it to a cubit from above, and set the door of the ark in its side. You shall make it with lower, second, and third decks. And behold, I myself am bringing floodwaters on the earth to destroy from under heaven all flesh in which is the breath of life. Everything that is on the earth shall die. But I will establish my covenant with you, and you shall go into the ark, you, your sons, your wife, and your sons' wives with you. And of every living thing, of all flesh, you shall bring two of every sort or kind into the ark to keep them alive with you. They shall be male and female. Of the birds after their kind, of the animals after their kind, and of every creeping thing of the earth after its kind. Two of every kind will come to you to keep them alive. And you shall take for yourself of all food that is eaten, and you shall gather to yourself, and it shall be food for you and for them. Thus Noah did according to all that God commanded him, so he did. And so now begins the story of that infamous flood that wiped out the world and everything in it. But now we have here his commandments to build the ark according to his specifications. And we find that that idea, remember we said, at least in the prayer, that the things that were written of old were written for our learning. So we look at the things that were written of old, and here we find God gave specific instructions. And Noah had to follow those specific instructions in order for that ark to float. Otherwise, we might have had the first submarine in human history. But he did all, it says, all that the Lord had commanded him. Now, he says here, make yourself an ark of gopher wood. That's very specific, isn't it? He didn't say, make yourself an ark of wood. He said, make yourself an ark of gopher wood. There's a difference. We don't know what gopher wood is. Some sort of a wood. Perhaps gophers fed upon it. Who knows? I don't really know. No one knows for sure. But whatever it was, he was to use it, and nothing else. And that's a great example for you and for me and for the church today. When God says something specific, we follow the specific. When God gives a generality, well, then we're free to follow out that command in a general fashion. So when he says, go into all the world and preach the gospel, that's a very general statement. He doesn't say, go into all the world by boat and preach the gospel. That would be very specific. But he says, go into all the world and preach the gospel. So we go into all the world by as many ways as we can, right? And we have now websites, worldwide websites, right? www.whatever.com. And so we have www.lakeroadcofc.com. And we have all that information in our website. Sermons uploaded, studies uploaded. We have other things that are being uploaded, and that'll continue to go on. And so we have all this scriptural, biblical information being uploaded that anyone in the world, and I suppose now, what was it, by 1980, I think it was 80% of the population of the world had televisions. And I think something along the same line, like 85% now of the world population, which is even grown since 1980, now approaching 8 billion people, 80%, 85% have computers, laptops, cell phones that are computers that they can access the internet. So we have 8 billion souls that can actually log into our website just by a search. They might be searching accidentally. Obviously, they'll be searching accidentally. They're not going to type in, oh, we've heard of the Lake Road Church of Christ. Too bad they didn't hear about it. But, right? But they're going to do that, and they might come across something for them on our website. But that's how we reach the world. We preach and we teach and we're going into the world by that fashion. We're going into the world by sending missionaries, right? Not everyone is called to go into the world, but the church collectively is called to go into the world. And so we can provide others to go on behalf of the church, and we've done that. And we preach and teach in the community, and we send out literature, and you talk to your friends and neighbors and so forth, and so we have all of this going on. And so we can go into the world by car and by horse and by whatever we like to do. There's nothing that says we can't go into the world by anything, right? He just says go. Whatever you need to do to get results, go. And that's the point. And so I want to bring your attention to Ephesians now. Ephesians chapter 5. This is a controversial passage in the religious world. You might not think it, but it is. Ephesians chapter 5, beginning in verse 19. We'll start in verse 20. We'll start in verse 18, actually. He says, "And do not be drunk with wine, in which is dissipation, but be filled with the Spirit." And now he's going to explain how we are to be filled with the Spirit. He says, "Speaking to one another in psalms and hymns and spiritual songs, singing and making melody in your heart to the Lord." So now we have something I believe is very specific for us. I think most people in olden days understood that. In fact, if you were to go and read some of the church fathers, as they're called, that date back to the second century, Jesus and the apostles lived in the first century, and after they're gone, the second, third, fourth, fifth, sixth, all the way up to the 21st century. But you go back to the second, third, fourth centuries, you're going to find people who read that and agree with us about this particular passage. It's very specific. And they will say, here's what we need to do when it comes to singing. Sing! That's what we're to do. Sing! And there's conspicuously, there's no mention of mechanical instruments of music, is there? They could have had that, just like they did in the Old Testament. Sing with the harps, sing with the lyre, sing with this and sing with that. None of that here is in the New Testament. Now it's just sing. It's just sing. And he says the making of melody. Now, the making of melody is an English translation. The literal rendering of the word psalantes there means plucking the strings of. So if we read it that way, notice what it says. Speaking to one another in psalms, in hymns, in spiritual songs, singing and plucking the strings of your heart to the Lord. That's literal, the literal rendering. A number of Greek and Roman historians, including Josephus, who was a Jew, commented on this particular passage. And I shouldn't say they commented on this particular passage. They commented on that particular word, psalantes. And it's always used as play when they use it. So, sing and play your heart to the Lord. right? They would always use sing and play the flute, sing and play the lyre. And so that's the idea of the word psalantos here. So specifically, we are to sing and play our heart to the Lord. That's a specific instrument, isn't it? God has indeed provided us an instrument to play. Figuratively, a figurative harp means a figurative instrument, right? But we find that it is the very instrument given. So that rules out, just like gopher wood. When he says build the ark out of gopher wood, that doesn't mean we can build the ark out of gopher wood and redwood, cedar, or anything else. By the specific given, that eliminates all other things. And that's the way God has asked us to approach the scripture when he says, do not go beyond things that are written. Do not add to his word or take away from his word. Do not go to the left of his word. Do not go to the right of his word. And so we find here those thoughts with this passage, singing and playing your heart to the Lord. That's what we're to play. It doesn't say sing and play your heart. Sing and play your heart and play something else. Sing and play your heart. That eliminates all other instruments. God has provided the instrument, whether people know that or not. And much of the religious world and much of the people today, they have no idea about this. They have no idea that God said what he said about how you're supposed to approach his word, that how you're supposed to read his word, how you are to apply his word. They know nothing about that. So when they see churches all around on TV and their neighborhoods, and they've grown up all that way, that's all they know. So when they hear that we don't use instruments, they kind of like, well, that's kind of odd, and that's kind of strange. Why is that? You know, I think you guys are weird, or maybe they're just too uptight, high-strung people. They're legalists, as they might say. They're too strict with the Word of God. Let me ask you, is it ever wrong to be strict with the Word of God? I mean, is it ever wrong to do exactly what God says to do? Obviously not, because that's what a command is. That's what obedience is to a command. If there's anything less than obedience, it can't be obedience. It's just doing something that you think is right with God, rather than obeying God and what he said. So, a lot of people, again, they're not accustomed to hearing this. They're not accustomed to knowing this, because they look about them and everyone uses instruments. Look on the television. They all got the drums and everything else. Exactly, yeah. Now, there was you've heard of the Reformation movement, right? Back in the 1500s. The Reformation was the beginning of what they call the Protestant movement, the Protestant movement. They protested what? You remember? Roman Catholicism, right? The Catholics controlled the church, what we call the Western side of the church. There was the Western side and the Eastern side. So the Western side really had all the power. And so in the 1500s, a guy by the name of Calvin and a guy by the name of Martin Luther, they came to the fore and they said, no longer can we do this. We can't follow Roman Catholicism because there's nothing taught in Scripture about some guy being the head of the church other than Christ. Christ is the head of the church, not someone who calls himself the Pope. And there were 94 other reasons that Luther nailed to the door at dark. And so he put down what they're called the 95 theses, or 95 reasons why we were leaving the Catholic Church, is really what it was saying. And so all those 95 reasons. Now, he put down a number of reasons that were great, some were not so great, but whatever the case is, they understood that there was a problem with that control of the Roman, we'll say Romanism. At the time, it was called Romanism. And so they put forth this Reformation movement. Let's reform the church. Now, what's the idea of reform?
To change.
So if we want to
reform, the case of straightening out of what you believe is wrong.
Exactly.
Not exactly just change for the sake of change. I believe this is wrong, and we need to change it to what I believe is right.
Exactly. Now, some of the major things of why they wanted to change was because, number one, the Pope, they didn't believe he was the head of the church, they believed Christ was the head of the church. They believed that legalism was wrong with all the different laws and rules and regulations that the church made up, including that of if you were to give money to the church, you could buy someone out of purgatory. Right? That was their number one reason, actually why these theses would go forward. So, if I wanted to get Roy out of purgatory, he could go to hell, he could go to heaven, but to make sure that he goes to the right place, I'm going to put down $15 toward Roy Raines. And they go into the ledger of their book and they wrote down Doug Post, $15 for the soul of Roy Raines. Then we sing then we light a candle. We light a candle, and then we turn around and we say, "Rise in heaven, boy! All right." That was wrong, according to many of these people.
It was the first attempt the church using the methods of fundraising because they were attempting to pay for that which had gone before, such as the Crusades. In a sense, the only thing. But they came upon some dire straits at some time, and what more tugging at a heartstring of saying, "Look, I know Grandpa didn't go to church, but we got a way out of this deal. We can just give, at the local monastery or whatever, we can give $100 and we're home free."
Right. Brother Harold has a good story. When he was growing up as a little boy in San Francisco, they lived above, they were poor, they lived above this brothel. Actually, they lived on the same floor of a brothel. There was a bar downstairs and a brothel upstairs, and everyone in town kind of knew the madam of the brothel. So that's the environment in which he grew up in. But they would go to church, and he was raised Roman Catholic, and every Sunday, the madam was at the Roman Catholic church, and she would dump in $100. Now, back in those days, that's huge, right? So she would dump in $100, and of course she would give more money at different various times of the season, Lenten season, and all this other stuff. So it'd be more than $100. But in any event, after she died, the Roman Catholic Church, knowing full well who this woman was, they buried her in their cemetery outside the building, outside the church, right? Now, what does that mean to a Roman Catholic? It means you're buried with the saints. You're buried with the saved. You're buried with the church, right? So they're going to heaven. That's what that meant. So she bought her way to heaven, as it were, even though she continued her life without repenting of her lewd lifestyle and her wicked ways. So, again, the people here that were bringing about the Reformation were saying, we need to go back to the Word of God. But they reformed. And there's a difference between reforming something and restoring something. You can reform something, but still hold on to certain aspects of what's there. But restoring something means you actually strip away everything. And you go back to the original. right? Just like you hear of restoration of a home, or restoration of a car, or restoration of one's soul, right? Someone comes forward to repent of their sins, to restore themselves, restore their souls, to go back to the original. The original is the cleanness, the purity, right? So if you're restoring the church, you're going back past Rome. You're going past Switzerland. And what do I mean by that? The East and the West. You're going back past the time of the Reformation. You're going back past the time of the Roman Catholic Church. And you're going back all the way to the first century church. That's the church we read about here in the Bible. And we say, we want to be like that. We want to do what they did, because we can read what they did. And if we do what they did, and they were called blessed, then we too will be blessed. It's that simple. And so during the 1800s, actually beginning in the 1700s, here in America, there was a group of men that said, yeah, we need to go back to the Bible, but we need to restore the church, to go back to the ancient order of things. And this is what happened, what we call the Restoration Movement. And out of that movement proceeded Churches of Christ. Not just Churches of Christ, but there were other people like Disciples of Christ, and of course the Christian church were all different. They, we believe, went their own separate ways at a later point. But the point being is this: we agreed that we don't need any creed, we don't need a catechism, we don't need people telling us what to believe, right? We just need to know God's word, to know what He tells us to believe. And that's all we need. That this is our creed. Anything less than the Bible, anything more than the Bible, is not the Bible. And that's what creeds and catechisms and all these other different things that come into play with all our churches. Because they'll say, we believe what the Bible says here, we believe this. And then they go on and they say, well, we believe this also. And this is something that you won't even find in the Bible. We believe this, and we believe this, and we believe this, and this is what we do. But you won't find those things in the Bible. So we say Churches of Christ are autonomous. We live and rule by our own selves. We don't answer to another church down the road, another Church of Christ. We don't answer to a Church of Christ in Nashville. We answer to God, and actually the elders who oversee the church, will answer to God. We too will answer to God as to how we follow the elders, as we how we followed the Word of God, right? So we're all in this together, and so when we say we need to speak where the Bible speaks, that means we're to speak the way it says. So just like Noah, when he said, or when God told Noah, make the ark out of gopher wood, God here is telling us the same way. He says, sing and play your harp to the Lord. That's what you play. No more, no less. So we want to go to heaven. This is what we believe. This is what we teach. But we go back to the Reformation, and even those people of the Reformation, we'll talk about Calvin, because he started the Presbyterian Church movement, if you will. He also influenced Baptists. He also influenced many others in the religious world through what's called Calvinism, right? So Calvin himself said that we might as well offer up sacrifices as play an instrument of music, because both are dead and gone and part of the old law. So he understood that we don't have a right to add instruments of music to the worship. And that's John Calvin. And how many people of their faith, if you will, Presbyterianism and others, know that? They don't have a clue of what their founders.
And it's always been that way. You know, what's the timeline? 600 years before Greek Orthodox, you know, like that? No, there was no sign of a musical instrument of any kind, even though if anybody could afford it, they could.
That's right.
At that point.
Right.
You went 600 years, at least in that particular message of that particular teaching, was never even up for debate. You did not use musical instruments.
That's right. That's why they called it a cappella, right? That's the, remember, the language of the world. The language of the world during the first century was Greek. Even the Romans, who ruled the world at the time, were speakers of Greek. They spoke Latin, but they also spoke Greek, just like the Jews. The Jews spoke Greek, but they also spoke Hebrew. Why is that? Because the Greek language was like, or was like, the English language today. What's the language of the world?
English,
right? So if you want to go into trade or into politics, you've got to be able to converse in English. And so when you go to other foreign countries, Switzerland, Sweden, Germany, all, they force their children to learn English because they need to know English to be able to operate in the world. Well, back then, everyone needed to know Greek to be able to operate in the world. Now, the Greek language died out as Rome grew in power, and they initiated an edict that says Latin. Latin is now the language. And so everyone had to learn Latin. And so the word a cappella is Latin for meaning as or in accordance with the chapel. We sing a cappella according to the chapel. And so a cappella meant without instruments, because that's the way they did it in the chapel, in the church. So even then, all through that time, there was no instruments of music, as Ben. You don't look like them either. As Ken pointed out, that for the most part, most everybody did not use instruments of music. It really wasn't until 1154 or 1054, so you're talking 1,054 years after Christ, 1054, when the west side of the church split with the east side. So the west was Roman, the east was Orthodox, Greek, and they split. And one of the reasons why they split was, just like when Calvin or Luther put up his 95 Theses, they also had reasons why. And one of the reasons they put up there is because the Romanism, as they would call it, Romanism offers vain worship to God by the use of mechanical instruments to God. That's what they said. So today, you have the Roman Catholic Church, and you also have the Greek Orthodox Church, two of the biggest churches in Christendom today. You got 1 billion adherents under Romanism, and they do mostly everything in their worship. And you have 1 billion or so, maybe a little less, 900 million, of Greek Orthodox adherents. And they still don't use instruments of music in their worship. We're not the only ones. There's more of them than there are of us, but we see that there's people that think alike because of this, because of God's word. Because of the very strict nature of God's word, which says, don't go beyond what is written. Well, what is written? Sing and play your heart to the Lord. That's written. Now, if I want to go beyond what's written, I'm going to say, sing and play your heart and play a trumpet and play a drum and play a guitar and play a... And so today, our youth are enamored with the kind of stylistic worship that you see on television today. Right? And so there's a church down the road, right? What's it called? The Crossing? They have strobe lights and they have lights, right? And you got people in there and they're singing. Not only are they singing, but they're dancing and they're boogieing down, all right? And that's an attraction to the youth. And they have no idea why they're doing it and why they shouldn't do it.
It's a numbers game.
Yeah.
For sure. No more, no less. It's a numbers game.
Yeah, it's like it's like the old days when you never offered candy to a little boy or to a little girl, right? Because it was something that was wrong. Well, that worship today is like that candy to a kid. They think nothing wrong with it. There's nothing wrong with it. Everyone does it. It must be right. Remember what Dad used to tell us? I don't care what they're doing. You do what I tell you. So if your buddy's going to jump off a bridge, you're going to go follow him along too? You know, those comments? Same thing. And that's exactly what God is saying here. Not in the same words, but he's saying, hey, don't add to anything that's been written. Because the Holy Spirit has put those words down. You follow what the Holy Spirit says. Don't add to what the Holy Spirit said. Don't take away. Don't diminish what the Holy Spirit has said. And so, a lot of people will simply, well, I'm not going to add to it. I'm not going to go beyond what is written. I'm not going to take away from it. I'm just going to ignore it. And that becomes their religion, their way of life. And so, we spent all this time talking about this one little verse, talking about how God commanded Noah to make an ark out of gopher wood, very specific. And just like that, we have specific commands in the New Testament that we need to understand, that take God at his word. Right? Take God at what he said, not what we think he might like. But based upon what he said, we do what he does. So with that, we'll come back to chapter 7 next week. We'll get into the flood. I said we were getting into the flood today. We didn't even get wet. So next week, we're going to get into the flood, chapter 7. So any questions, any comments? All right. Thank you for your kind attention.
I didn't have to bring the butter.